I could have everyone make their way back to their seats and be quiet, please. I'm just going to ask for like some sympathy quietness here because I really can't scream over all of you today. If you could please make your way back to your seats, we're going to get started soon. I'm going to go ahead and introduce our next speaker. I'm so excited to introduce our speaker this morning. Dr. Matt Manwell is currently an associate professor of political science at Central Washington University, where he teaches political economy and constitutional law. It wasn't mentioned in my bio, but I graduated from Central Washington for my undergraduate degrees, and so I'm a big fan of Dr. Manweller. Prior to teaching at CWU, he was a high school economics, math, and social studies teacher. He also serves in the Washington State House of Representatives. He is currently the ranking member of the House Labor Committee, and he is the member of the Republican leadership team, serving as deputy floor leader. He also drew the short stick having me introduce him this morning, unfortunately, but he earned his bachelor's in economics and teaching certificate from Whitman College, his master's degree from the University of Montana, and his PhD from the University of Oregon. He is the author of several scholarly books and articles on tort reform, voting behavior, state court procedures, and constitutional law. Prior to running for office, Dr. Manweller was a regular columnist for the Daily Record and occasionally published articles for the Seattle Times, the Washington Times, and other regional newspapers. He also produced and hosted several TV and radio shows, such as A Christian Viewpoint on Christian Broadcasting of Yakima, Point to Point on CWU TV, and The Right Opinion on KXLE. Dr. Manweller has served on several boards, including the Research Advisory Board of the Washington Policy Center and the Board of Directors of the Freedom Foundation, Ellensburg Chamber of Commerce, and Hope Source. Dr. Manweller was also my professor and my advisor during my undergraduate studies at Central. He has served for many years as the advisor to the university's only conservative club, and he has guided the club through, shall we say, some interesting times. As such a liberal university, I once asked Dr. Manweller how he survived being such an outspoken conservative, and I believe his exact words to me were, "I kept my mouth shut until I had tenure." He made it all the way from the great state of Washington, so please join me in welcoming Dr. Matt Manweller.
All right, well, thank you, Jolie. I've known Jolie for years. That's actually her real voice. She's just making it up about the whole I lost my voice thing. Many of you believe that you're more likely to find a unicorn on campus than a conservative professor, so I just wanted to take a moment.
Right here, baby. Yeah, yeah.
If anybody wants a picture to prove that it's true, you know, you can say, I found one. I found Waldo. Who's the guy from UCI? Go Anteaters. I'm an anteater. I did first half of my undergraduate work at the University of California, Irvine. My wife, who's in the back here, a Missouri grad. So she's hanging her head in shame this week, but she's fighting the good fight for all of us. So here's what I'm going to try to do in the next, what time I have been allotted. I'm going to try to talk to you about a famous piece of conservative political theory known as The Road to Serfdom by F.A. Hayek. How many of you have ever been assigned this book in a class? Yeah, about two of you. Of course not. It's only the foundation of most Western thought, so why in God's name would we actually teach it in a university? How many of you have ever been assigned a book by Milton Friedman? Three or four more. This was Milton Friedman's professor. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you about what is considered one of the top 10 most influential books in conservative thought. I'm going to try to tie it to a little bit of history, and then I'm going to try to connect it to Obamacare, and all at the same time, have a little bit of fun. So we're going to do some different stuff today than might typically be me talking at you. And we're going to start out with the most complicated of them. So bear with me. I need you, if you are from here over, to get up and come stand in this area right here. Just leave your stuff there. Stand in that space. And if you are from here over, I need you to come stand in this space. I know, it's going to be crowded.
Sorry.
I'll use this for a while. I won't need this the whole time. We're going to try to make this as confusing and crowded as possible. All right. Spread yourself out a little bit. I'm going to give you a simple yet complicated task. I need everybody on this side of the room to somehow make their way to this side of the room. And I need everybody on this side of the room to make your way to that side of the room. And the only rule is you cannot touch another human being. Okay? You cannot touch another human being. Ready? Go. Do not touch another human being. Switch sides of the room. Make decisions. Weave, Bob. How we doing? Anybody bump into anybody yet? Anybody violate the rules? Nobody has cooties? All right. Nobody has cooties but Jolie today, right? Yeah. Okay. Da-dun, da-dun, da-dun. Wow. Now have a seat for me. Now have a seat. I know you're thinking, what in the heck is he doing? Have a seat. Go back to your chair. Yeah. Fine, whatever. Uh-oh, you broke the rules. There we go. Okay. All right. What does that have to do with the road to serfdom? What does that have to do with conservative politics? So, anybody here have any background in computer programming? Anybody? That guy right there. What's your name? Alec, if I were to ask you to create a computer program that did what we just accomplished, how many lines of code are we talking about? To move 100 people through obstacles, different size people, different strides, almost no information about their directional ability. If I asked you to create a computer program to do what I just did, what would it take you? A lot. More than you have. More than you have. Okay, thank you. I want you to think, if you don't have a background in computers, and I ask you simply, I'd like you to write a strategic plan. I'd like you to put it out on paper, word for word, how you're going to take 100 students in this size room with these desks and these chairs and another 100 people over here. How many pages do you think we're talking about?
Less than one.
Less than one. Yeah. Okay, there's one idea. Let me ask you this. How did you do it? I want you to think about that. I had hundreds of people in here. Okay, you all have different size bodies. You all take different steps. You didn't know what you're... How were you able to do what you did in an anarchical system? I didn't tell you where to walk. I didn't tell you how fast to walk. I didn't tell you how long to walk. I gave you almost no direction other than, please switch sides of the room. How did you do it without crashing into each other? Why didn't we have mayhem? Why didn't we have bonked heads, spilled drinks, twisted ankles, tipped over chairs? How did it happen? How did it happen? Anyone want to tell you? Yes. Okay, you had access to certain information. Right? Oh, I see somebody in front of me. Maybe I should slow down. Maybe I should move to the left. Right? How is it that I was able to do it with no code? And what was your name, Alex? Yeah, Alex says he would take more programming skill than he has. I have no programming skills. I'm so happy when my Commodore 64 turns on. How'd that happen? Let's just take that question for a moment, okay? And as they say nowadays, put a pin in it. I just want you to hold that little exercise that we just did. And I'm going to come back to it. Because it's going to come back to about the notion of information costs. And instead, I'm going to ask you a seemingly and completely unrelated question. How many of you are going somewhere for Christmas break this year? How many of you are going on some type of vacation? One, two, three. Okay, great. I want to know where you're going, okay? Where are you going on Christmas break?
I'm going to Snow Basin up in northern Utah.
Snow Basin, Utah. Okay, somebody else. Just throw it out. Yeah.
Houston, Texas.
Houston, Texas. All right. Houston, Texas. Oops. Well, maybe. There we go. Houston, Title IX. Yes. What?
Hong Kong.
Hong Kong. This is going to be so much fun. Okay. You guys are making this easy for me. Yes.
Palm Springs, California.
Palm Springs. All right. Springs. Not far from my old town. Yes?
Nepal.
Nepal. Okay. Nepal. Yes, sir. Really? Okay. Okay. So I don't have a lot of rules in my class and lectures. The one rule is that you can only answer with words that I can spell. So it does generally limit you to monosyllabic words, but we're going to go with Japan. Where else? Yes. Switzerland. Okay. I am so hanging out with the wrong people. I'm going to, like, Seattle, maybe. Yeah.
Columbia, Missouri.
Columbia. Okay. Columbia. And one more. One more. Yes, ma'am.
No, I was planning a trip to Paris, but I'm rethinking that.
Okay. Good point. Good point, though. But that's going to be helpful. Okay. My Snow Basin guy. Where are you, Snow Basin guy? Why?
I like to ski.
You like to ski. Good enough. Just going to Houston. Why?
Family.
Oh, family, right? Like ski, I want to go visit my family. Hong Kong guy?
Family.
JJ. It's unfortunate your family and her family don't live in the same city. That's going to be a problem in a minute, okay? Who's going to Palm Springs? Why?
Family tradition and change of scenery.
Change of scenery, it's the dead of winter. You'd like to see the sun and warm, okay.
And also the climate there is way different than Los Angeles.
It's completely different, yeah. Yes, right. The golf courses are totally different. Who's going to Nepal?
It's a mission trip.
A mission? You are going for religious reasons. Okay, awesome. Glad that you came on the list. Japan?
Family and Navy.
Family? Oh, and Navy. So in some ways related to your career. I want you to think about this career, religion, family, climate, what I like to do. My family doesn't live with your family. Switzerland, yes.
Snowboarding.
Yeah. You two should talk. Colombia. I bet you you're not going for snowboarding. Where's Colombia, person? Yes.
Born and raised in the literal bastion that is Columbia, Missouri.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're just going back to visit your home. Okay, and why are you not going to Paris now?
Because there's terrorism attacks.
Because you're uncomfortable. Where might you go instead?
Stay at home.
Stay at home. Okay, that's fine. Easy question. Easy answers. Don't you wish all your quizzes and finals were like that? Right? Thank you for 10 weeks. Where are you going on vacation? A or an F, right? Okay. I'm going to change the question. Where are we going on vacation this Christmas? Think about that. Where are we going to go on vacation? By my guess, there's about 100 of you in this room. If I make a simple change in the question from where are you going on vacation to where are we going on vacation, I want you to think about how that fundamentally changes the dynamic of this room. What are some of those changes? What do we now have to decide?
Where we go as a unit.
Where we go as a unit, collectively, all together. So what are some questions that we are going to have to confront that we did not have to confront 5 minutes ago?
Conflict of interest.
Conflict of interest, okay. What were you going to say? I thought you seemed like you were almost going to weigh in here. What? Okay, so one of the issues is you have different preferences, right? Some of you want to go for some places, some of you want to go another way, okay? How should we decide? Sorry, folks. I am telling you right here and now that
You are not going on vacation chaotically like the way I had you cross the room, where you all got to walk where you wanted to walk, as fast as you wanted to walk, in the direction you wanted to walk. I can't have anarchy. Anarchy is chaos. We need a plan. We need a plan if we're going to move forward. And so we need to plan where we are going on vacation. So the first problem we're going to have to discover or deal with is where. I swear I did graduate third grade, okay? Where? I'm a little nervous. Okay. Suggestions. How do we decide?
Take a vote.
We could take a vote. There we go. It's not the only possibility. What type of vote? Majority? Two-thirds? Unanimous? What do you think?
I said majority.
You were going to go majority, okay. It's getting more complicated, though, isn't it? Is that the only option? Anybody think that we should have more than just the majority? Yes.
Maybe we should vote
one off at a time. Oh, okay, so we should play Survivor, yeah. Right? We'll have somebody come up, their little thing gets put out, right? You know, sorry, Nepal, you've been voted off the island, okay? We could do a regression of who has the least vote, and then vote again, and least votes, and vote again, okay? That's an option. What else? Could we go with unanimity? We don't go anywhere unless we all agree.
That's impossible.
I talked to Bernie Sanders, it's doable. Other options. Besides unanimity, majority, vote one down at a time. So kind of basically a runoff after runoff after runoff, right? These are questions we didn't have to ask when I said, where are you going on vacation? But these are questions we have to ask when I ask, where are we going on vacation? All right, folks. Well, there's your list. You are going to get one vote. How many of you want to go to Snow Basin, Utah? Raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I thought I saw 6, okay? Well, let's go to Houston. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You're winning. Hong Kong. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Palm Springs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh, we have a new winner. 10. Nepal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Can we vote more than once?
No, you can't, not unless you're from Seattle or Chicago. How many of you want to go to Japan? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Apparently there's a Japanese wing of voters over here, right? Okay. Switzerland. Oh, yeah. So sad you picked Switzerland. I didn't even count. 23. I work for government. I don't have to be accurate. Colombia. Colombia. 1, 2. Even my wife didn't vote for Colombia. 3. Paris. No, nobody wants to put Paris today.
I can vote twice. I'm from Chicago.
Okay, you're from Chicago. Okay. So, setting aside democratic theory for a moment about whether we should have runoffs or whether we should have a majority vote or a plurality vote, let's say that Switzerland's our winner.
That's fine.
Okay. By a show of hands, how many of you did not pick Switzerland?
I mean, that's going to be second choice.
Okay. What happens? What do you think our next question is going to be? We have chosen as a society, we be going to Switzerland. What is the next question?
When?
Oh, really? Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why I said I'm so glad you picked Switzerland. Okay. How should we now pay for our collective trip to Switzerland? We'll make the rich pay. Okay. Who is Democratic? Okay. Okay. We could make the rich people. Okay. Who in here is rich? Yeah. Socialism's great till you run out of other people's money. Okay. How will we pay for this? Oh, equally? Okay, how many of you think that I should buy, let's just say that there's 100 of you in here for the simple of mathematics, right? Let's say there's 100 of you. Do I go out and buy 100 tickets to Switzerland, 100 hotel rooms for, well, didn't even get to the details. How long should we stay, folks? Okay, I hear 2 weeks, so I hear a different number.
1 week.
1 week.
10 days.
10 days. 3 days. Okay. Boy, do I need a lot of information. In fact, it's becoming very close, like coming up with a computer program to get 50 people and 50 people to switch sides of a room. Oh, picking a desk. How many of us want to go on vacation for Christmas break? Oh, hey, there's unanimity. We started out so simple, didn't we? How many of you want to go on vacation? We all say yes. How many of you want to go to Switzerland? Now we're down to 23 out of 100. How many of you want to go to Switzerland for 2 weeks? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you want to go for 10 days? Okay. How many of you want to go for 3 days? Okay. Started out in the generic, we all want to go on vacation. Then it's like, when only 23 of us actually wanted to go to Paris, and maybe only of those, some of us wanted to go for 10 days. But okay, we'll go for 10 days. For 10 days. So now, back to the cost question. I buy 100 tickets, airline tickets to Switzerland, a hotel for 10 days, okay? And it comes up to a total. How do I pay for it? Do I take that total and divide by 100?
Sure.
How many of you don't want to pay? How many of you, if I sent you a notice from the United States government saying that we decided that Christmas break this year, you are all going to Switzerland, and you will be at the airport. Oh gosh, didn't even get to the question of when we should leave. I'm sure every one of your schools gets out on the exact same day, right? How many of you want to leave on December 10th? 11th? 12th? 23rd? How many of you want to wait till after Christmas? How many of you want to spend Christmas with your family, then go to Switzerland? How many of you want to leave before Christmas? A lot of information to collect here. Okay? So, at the end of the day, I send you a letter, and it says, you will arrive at the airport on December 17th. You will send me a check for $5,000. You will go to Switzerland. You will stay there for 10 days, and you will arrive back on December 27th. How many of you would not show up at the airport and not send me a check? What's happening to the plan? Okay.
Well, we have the third and most important question.
How do we enforce the plan? The plan doesn't work unless we're all on board. If some of you don't write me a check, I don't have enough money to pay for the plan. What might some of you want to do instead? You might want to do your own thing, right? What are we going to do with the troublemaker? What are we going to do? He's not following the plan. What should we do? We don't take him? Okay. Do we still take his money? Okay. If I don't take his money, I don't have enough money for the plan to work. I don't have enough money for the tickets or the hotel. I only got a deal if I bought him in block. So if he doesn't show up, guess what? The rest of you can't go. So do we make him pay and tell him he doesn't have to come? Or what's our other option? Oh, well, he can't do what activities? Whatever we say. Okay? What else are we going to do? What other options do we have to do with our troublemaker here? How many of you would not show up at the airport on December 17th? Oh, folks, we got a bigger problem than we thought. It's not one troublemaker. It sounds like half of you are troublemakers. Okay, so for those of us who are, okay, what are we going to do with these people who just raised their hands? What are my options? I'm not saying what you would do. Tell me what my options are.
Yes.
Scrap the whole trip altogether.
Scrap the trip altogether. No vacation for anyone. Play by the rules or you get nothing. Okay?
Hire an enforcer.
Hire an enforcer. Men with guns and badges who show up at your house and say, hey, buddy, it's December 17th. Get packed. Get in the car. You're going to Switzerland. That's option two. What's another option? Yes.
Find somebody else to replace them.
You're out. We're going to go get somebody else. Okay, yes.
Have someone else pay the cost so he doesn't worry about that.
Who do we get?
The rich old people.
Take it from somebody else. What Friedrich Hayek would say is, you are all, my friends, on a long, slow road to serfdom. Okay? You're on a long, slow road to serfdom because what did we do here? In a matter of 15 minutes, we went from a generalized goal, which Hayek said is the simplicity of all societies. How many of you agree on equality? Right? How many of you disagree on what equality actually is? How many of you believe in fairness? Okay? It is easy to vote and agree on a generalized goal. How many people believe in vacation? Picking the generalized goal was so simple. But then, when we got into the specifics, where should we go? How should we go? Who should go? Where should we pay? How should we pay for it? A bunch of students who were invited to Yale because you generally like freedom, in a matter of 15 minutes, came to the conclusion, we should take other people's money. We should send people with armed guards. We should go capture somebody and make them go where they don't want to go. What happened to the freedom-loving YAF students I had 20 minutes ago, right? The basic theories of the road to serfdom are twofold. One, no government can ever collect enough information about all of your preferences in order to devise a competent plan. And that's why I had you walk back and forth. I could have spent the first hour and a half saying, how tall are you? How long is your stride? If you meet somebody, do you tend to go left or go right? Right? I could have spent hours and hours collecting that information, giving it to my computer guy and said, go create a program that will get 50 kids over here and 50 kids over here to switch places with collecting information about where chairs were and where desks were. And 10 years later, we might have had a plan. And if you want an example of that, go study how the Russians produced food in the 1960s and 70s. They would try to figure out how many shoes they needed, what size they would need, right? No one in America did that. The market did it. Just as I did not collect that information. I said, you know what? Figure out yourself. Be anarchical. All I'm going to do is give you the generalized goal. Switch sides of the room. You had information about how long your stride was. You had information about whether you go left or right when you meet another person. You were able to look at what other people were doing and adjust, right? As anarchical as that was, okay, you were able to do it, okay? But on the second part, with the plan, we realized what Hayek said was, you cannot have a plan and freedom. And what led Hayek to write his book is he says, why is it that all socialist countries also become totalitarian countries? Why is it that an economic system that does not have anything to do with politics, why is it that countries that started out with socialism always end up as totalitarian? Was there something in their DNA? Was there something in their culture? And he said, no. Once you have a collective plan, the only way to accomplish a collective plan is to have force. If you want to all go different places, but we all want you to go one place, then we need men with guns and badges to go to these people and say, you're not going to Nepal. You're not going to Houston. You're not going to Hong Kong. You're going to Switzerland. That's the plan. Well, what if I don't want to go? We will use force to make you. What if I don't want to pay? Then we'll take it out of your paycheck. Right? We'll put you in prison. Right? You cannot have an economic plan and freedom. And if you try to have an economic plan, he said, you will start your first steps down the road to serfdom. So this is theory. So in the 5 minutes that I have left, let's talk about Obamacare. How many of you believe that everybody deserves quality health care? Yeah, that's easy, isn't it? The question is how? Do we let everybody go to get their own doctors? Do we ever let everybody pick out their own insurance plan? Boy, that sounds anarchical, chaotic, like kids walking back and forth. What we need is a plan, right? And so what did we tell people? Okay, everybody, you have to go out and buy health insurance. But guess what? We live in a free country. Some people said, I don't want to buy health insurance. So what did we tell them? You have to. And if you don't,
you'll be fine.
You will be fine. Absolutely. The first step down the road to serfdom. I, Barack Obama, have a plan. And my plan is, you don't get to pick your health care plan. I get to pick your health care plan. You don't decide whether or not you have health insurance or no. The plan is we all have it. But millions of Americans said, I don't want it. I'm not going to buy it. Okay, fine. $2,000 a year or 2% of your income. You will follow the plan or I will punish you. I will use the legitimate use of force that we call the state, and I will make you buy a plan. Okay, Mr. President, I'll buy a plan. Can I buy my own plan? Can I decide what's in it? No. Everybody has to have the same plan. It has to cover birth control. It has to cover abortion. We work for Hobby Lobby. We're a Christian organization. We would prefer to buy a plan that doesn't cover birth control because it violates our religious beliefs. We're going to sue you then. We're going to fine your company $1 million a day. You will cover birth control or we will take your business away. Is this starting to sound familiar? Mr. President, we're a group of nuns. We would like to buy a health care plan that does not cover abortion. No. You don't have a choice. We pick Switzerland. One plan for everyone. You will buy an insurance plan or I will fine you $2,000. You will cover contraception or I will take your company away. And sister, you will cover abortion or I will take your monastery away. Are we not on the road to serfdom? You cannot have an economic plan and political freedom. If you try to do both, one has to give way to the other. And so what Hayek was famous for, what he won the Nobel Prize in economics for, is saying is that, Mr. Sanders, if you want an economic plan, then you have to give up political freedom. And that is why every society in the history of the world that has tried to have a collectivist economic system has ended up with a totalitarian political system. And that's what Reagan and Thatcher understood. And I will wrap up, because Margaret Thatcher, who predated Reagan by about 2 years, had an economic advisor. His name was Keith, James? The Mad Monk, they called him. And he had a copy of The Road to Serfdom everywhere he went. And he gave one to Margaret Thatcher, and he said, Margaret Thatcher, this is the book. This is how we're going to transform England. And F.A. Hayek had a student, and his student's name was Milton Friedman. And Milton Friedman was Ronald Reagan's chief economic advisor. So this book, the author of this book, F.A. Hayek, is responsible for leading the intellectual revolution that Margaret Thatcher led to defeat socialism in Britain. And his student was the intellectual advisor to President Ronald Reagan, who led the conservative free market revolution in the United States that pushed back the Jimmy Carters and the Lyndon Baines Johnson. And my advice to you, if you pick only one book to read that is not on your reading list, read The Road to Serfdom, because most of the economics of the world is based on his book. And the great irony, folks, is that before you graduate, every one of you will read Marx. And there are about six countries left in the world that base their economies on the theories of Marx. And none of you will be asked to read The Road to Serfdom. And the other 187 countries in the world base their economic theories on this book. I'll take your questions.
Questions?
Hi, first off, thanks for coming to the conference. I really enjoyed it. My name is Jake. I'm from Truman State University. I couldn't agree more with your analysis of Hayek and how it's not talked about. I've taken econ classes. I'm a political science major, but I've taken a lot of econ support with it. And I'm in a political thought class right now, and it's interesting you bring up Marx, because I'm right in the middle of going through Marx with a Marxist professor, honestly, who never perked up in a lecture until we started talking about Marx. It seems like a lot of economics has shifted to more of an ideological perspective of economics instead of an actual analysis of system, because we're all taught Kantian economics. We don't touch Hayek. And so how do we combat that? How do we combat the more liberal philosophies that the Kantian economics brings into the system and combat it with where we stand from the Hayek perspective?
The question was asked earlier, how do you confront your professors and say, I'd like to hear the other side, right? One of the things that I advise my students is I said, steal their language. Professor, I don't feel like this class is a safe space for me. Are all voices valued, right, in this class? I believe in diversity, and I'm particularly concerned in intellectual diversity. So I really appreciate your lecture about Marx. What do you think about us as a class reading Hayek so that we can have a debate, right? Use their language, okay, and turn it back on them. I find it very effective. One of my students, very good at that. But, at the end of the day, professors are in control of their own syllabi. Either read it on your own and interject it into the lecture yourself. Say, Professor, I appreciate what you're saying about Marx, but when he talks about this, this, and this, I'm interested, how does that conflict with Nobel Prize winner and founder of the Chicago School of Economics, F.I. Hayek, when he says this, this, and this? If he won't let you read it, you interject it into the lecture. But again, I would also go back to a little bit of what Joe Lee said. If you're gonna be a conservative on campus, and you're gonna have the backbone to stand up to your professors a little bit and push back in a polite way, you do not have the luxury of being as good as your other students. You have to be better, okay? I am a conservative professor who has tenure, okay? And I did that because the rules were you need 4 peer-reviewed journal publications. I did 11, right? You do not have the luxury of being as good if you're gonna choose to be an openly conservative student. You have to be better. Okay? It's just the reality of it. And so if you want to take on that task, you can't do it half-assed. Okay? You can't have read the back jacket of The Road to Serfdom. You need to read the whole book. You need to know it well. And that way, if you engage, you engage in a superior footing. Other questions? Yes, sir.
My name's Anthony Murray. I'm from the University of Tampa with a few other of my colleagues sitting back there. I just want to know, what makes professors, other economic liberal advisors think that, the majority concept population, whatever, is still a predominant way to go. I mean, as you can see from the student population we even have here, it creates chaos. And I don't understand from an economic perspective why it's still valid.
Yeah, I mean, it's hilarious. If you ever read the opening introduction of The Road to Serfdom, it talks about how, despite the fact that Marxism has been discredited around the world, there's one place that it still finds a safe space, and that is the universities of America, right? The question is, why is it that despite the fact that after the fall of the Soviet Union, the collapse of almost every socialist-based system, every communist-based system, you still have academics who are in some ways divorced from the real world, still believing that there's a path forward. Hayek actually coined a term, and I would suggest you look it up. It was called the fatal conceit. And it was the notion that socialism always fails, not because socialism is wrong, but the last guy that tried it didn't do it right. And if you got the right socialist, then it would work. Most professors suffer from the fatal conceit. Russia fell because Stalin got it wrong, not because communism is wrong, Stalin didn't do it right. The Chinese government turned and collapsed, not because communism wasn't right, Mao just didn't do it right. It's failing in Sweden and Finland simply because they're not doing it correctly. So the Marxist professors that you have suffer something called the fatal conceit. Google it, read it on Wikipedia. It's a good term to have as you engage in debate. But that's the best answer I can give you, is that if they would just do it right, and what Hayek reads in the Rights and the Road to Serfdom is, you can't do it right. You cannot do it right, and as soon as we accept that. And I'd also point out to your professor that the very liberal Swedish Nobel Committee said, this guy deserves a Nobel Prize in economics. How much time do we have left? Oh, we can take more. Yes, ma'am. Right here. Oh, you guys are picking? Go.
All right. My name is Skylar. I'm from the University of Missouri. The question I have to you is kind of a moral dilemma my friend posed upon me. So answer this however you can. He said, how is it fair to like tell these families who can't afford health care that their families don't get it, even though like they're in need?
Okay. Hayek and Friedman have absolutely no overriding objection to a social welfare state, okay? So I would like you to divorce two concepts, the idea of a social welfare state and the idea of a universal or singular plan. Right? What Hayek and Friedman said is, if you have people in your society that do not have health care, there's nothing fundamentally immoral or invading of freedom to provide them with some basic level of health care. What he is going to argue is that the individual amount of information that could never be collected by the government, but is collectively there in each of your individual minds, you will be able to choose a varied product. You would probably want a healthcare system, a plan that doesn't cover mammograms and pregnancy. I'm just gonna go out on the limb, right? Other people here may want one. I don't need things that other people do. So what all Hayek is saying in The Road to Serfdom is, let everybody pick their own healthcare plan, okay? Don't say we have to pick one healthcare plan for everybody, because once you head down that road, you have to tell a majority of people you can't have what you want, and you must have what you don't want, and therefore you must pay for something that you don't want. He says, once society can tell you you cannot have what you want, you must pay for what you do not want, you are on the road to serfdom. So divorce the concept of a singular plan and a social welfare state. They're not the same thing. Yes. Oh, no, actually, I don't get to pick.
My name is Caleb, and I'm going to go to Liberty University, and I'm actually an exercise science major, but I think this is a pressing issue. So I guess, what are some practical steps that I could take to kind of tackle this sort of issue?
When you say the issue, are you talking about intellectual diversity? Are you talking about what Hayek's talking about? Can you frame that?
Well, like, I guess like this form of like socialist economic kind of standpoint.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, we professors are great at pointing out the problem, aren't we? Providing a solution is a little bit different. But if you're looking at this idea of how do we as a society say that, you know, government-mandated choice infringes on freedom, I think that's why we're here. I mean, obviously, you have people who donate money to YAF. You guys are willing to fly in here. You have staff. We're dedicated to the idea, right, that at the end of the day, you can only accomplish this when you have an intellectual change at the societal level, right? So, I mean, this is kind of what Reagan did. Reagan took a fundamental model that was the predominant model in the 1970s, which was Keynesian in nature, Marxist in nature, collectivist in nature, and he said, you know what? What about the Chicago School? the Chicago school founded by F.A. Hayek, who fled the Nazis, right, from Austria and brought the Austrian school. You know what? When F.A. Hayek was hired at the University of Chicago, he couldn't get a job in the economics department because he was a free market economist. And it was so discredited in the 1930s that he was only hired in the philosophy department. Keynesianism was the dominant only thought. Marxism was the only thought. So Hayek said, okay, I'm going to work in the philosophy department, and I'm going to get a handful of students. And we're going to do research, and we're going to write books. And one of his students was Milton Friedman. Right? And at the time, you think about this daunting task. How can five men at the University of Chicago's philosophy department change the world? But the men that they taught ended up being mentors to a young member of parliament named Margaret Thatcher, a governor of California named Ronald Reagan. Those five people influenced the right five other people, and those two people changed the world, right? So why am I here? I mean, I don't teach in California. None of you are my students. I had to get on a plane to be here, and I hate flying, right? But I don't know who you're gonna work for. Somebody in this room might be whispering in the ear of the President of the United States in 15 years. Some of you might end up being the economic advisor to some governor in a blue state. And my hope is that when you're whispering in your ear, you're gonna say, you know what, 15 years ago, I listened to this crazy professor talk about this book called The Road to Serfdom, and I wanna tell you about it before you get sworn in. That's the answer to your question. Thank you, guys.